ब्रह्मादिभ्यो ब्रह्मविद्या संप्रदाय कर्तृभ्यो वंशऋषद्भ्यो महद्भ्यो नमो गुरुभ्यः सर्वोपप्लवरहितप्रज्ञानघनप्रत्यगर्थो ब्रह्माहमस्मि सोऽहमस्मि ब्रह्माहमस्मि। ॐ प्रपन्नपारिजाताय तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। ओम नमो वेंकटेशाय। माय बेस्ट विशेस एंड परिपूर्ण आशीर्वादम्स टू ऑल द व्यूवर्स ऑफ श्री वेंकटेश्वर भक्ति चैनल। मे द ऑलमाइटी श्री लॉर्ड वेंकटेश्वर बेस्टू ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ प्रॉस्पेरिटी हेल्थ वेल्थ एंड इटर्नल हैप्पीनेस विद परिपूर्ण लक्ष्मी कटाक्षम्स टू यू एंड एंटायर योर फैमिली मेंबर्स एंड फ्रेंड्स। लेट अस बिगिन भगवद्गीता that we are seeing the summary of 9th chapter. We have completed up to verse number 10. So first three verses Bhagavan used for introducing the content of this 9th chapter. Then from 4 to 10, Bhagavan introduced the para prakriti, the higher nature of the Ishvara. Now from verse number 11 to 14, he just brings what is samsara karana. Because the fact, according to the last, you know, verses, from verse number 4 to 10, what exists is nothing but God. God is abstractum and God is unaffected by the creation. Creation exists in the God alone. See, when you understand about a personality, so when we want to understand about an actor, we just go and browse in Google. If you want to know about a scientist, you just Google, you will come to know. So when he started the career and what and all that he invented and what and all the benefit by his invention the world has received. So according to that, you start respecting that personality. But God is the personality. So when you attempt to know, you become amazed because the knowledge which is known as secret, it remains a secret even after understanding. I mean, the God concept, once you realize, you will get one doubt. If everything is God, then why do we suffer? So God means what? Sat Chit Anandam. Anandam means it's a happiness. This happiness, how can bring sadness to me? If God is everything, if God is substratum, if God alone becomes the base of the world, then why everybody is suffering, not only me, all creatures are suffering. And not only creatures, the animals, plants, everything is suffering. This suffering is caused by what? Why do we suffer? When you ask this question, you have improved student, what I mean to say. Because now you are asking why the creation had happened. Now you are asking everything is Ishvara, then why the suffering is happening. Now you have developed a little bit. We say the answer, just simple, because you are lacking the knowledge of Ishvara. Swamiji, just you are just returning our question. I am asking if everything is Ishvara, then why do we suffer? That's what I am saying, my dear. If you understand everything is Ishvara, suffering goes away. I don't find, because I could understand what you said, everything may be Ishvara. Yes, that maybe should go. When will it go? It will go. For that, what should I do? Continue Gita. There are upayas, there are solutions are given. But that solution is given in different way. The Bhagavan Krishna is making a different way. He says, so when you are not understanding the higher nature of the Ishvara, that becomes cause of the suffering. So when I am lacking of Ishvara's knowledge from the birth alone, we are born with ignorance. So why do we born with ignorance? Because of the ignorance, the birth happens. Otherwise, birth won't happen. Take a chalo, kaise bhi ho. So whatever it is, go further. Let me know the solution. They say, this there are one more nature called Aparaprakriti, otherwise called Mayaji. That Mayaji veils you. Achha. In the last class I said, it veils you from your buddhi. Okay, the mistake is happening from me. No, it's not at all mistake. It is the normal phenomenon. It is known as a life. Life is to realize Ishvara. Till that realization, life should go safer side as a secured one. But the thing is that security is that much tight enough, you don't feel comfortable. Okay? You don't feel comfortable. That's all. You are like a kid. So when a kid, when it wants to walk, you know, newly born baby, after 1 year, it wants to walk. But mom is grabbing her. She doesn't want to, let the baby to walk. Why? Because if baby walks without any security, baby will get injured. In order to avoid that injury of her own baby, she controls. In the same way, Mayaji controls so that you may not collapse yourself. First of all, you should understand in that way. We are veiled, therefore we are joyful people. We are kept away from the future knowledge. We are kept blind. Because if I come to know in future what will happen, definitely I will suffer more. If I am not able to forget about last birth, I will suffer more. Like this Maya concept is brought from verse number 11. But it is brought in different way than the 7th chapter deals with Maya. In the 7th chapter, just he said, Mama Maya Duratyaya. And he, in the beginning itself, he introduced, you know, there is Apara Prakriti. It has divided into 8 forms. Bhumi Rapo Nalo Vayuho Kammano Buddhirevacha Ahankarayati Yamme Bhinna Prakriti Rashtadha. Just he introduced the Srishti is called Prakriti. That Prakriti is nothing but Maya. But here it has got a system. Because of the Maya, you are protected. Because of the Maya, you are suffering. Because of the Maya, you are protected means that's what the Maya's karya. But when you lack of Paraprakriti, the knowledge of higher nature of Ishvara, then this Maya seems to be making or seems to be bothering you a lot. No. The Maya is very much is needed for us. We have to surrender to Maya. How can we surrender to Maya? By surrendering to Ishvara. That's what Bhagavan Krishna puts in different way. The people who are ignorant to higher nature, they suffer. And they find hell in this life. That's what explanation from verse number 11. Then their all activities, whole life, doesn't matter how many janmas they make, all of them are vain. Because they are hunted by the nature of Maya, because Maya has got 3 gunas. The 2 gunas, Rakshasim, Asurim, with Rajoguna and Tamoguna, they will be collapsed. Therefore, we have to be respectful towards Maya. Because Maya is everything. You have to be respectful with the Srishti, with carefulness. That's what Maya has got one more side. That one more side is Sattva Guna side. If you surrender to Maya, she will bless us with her Sattva Guna. Therefore, people who are endowed with Sattva Guna, they are able to make effort. That's what Mahatmanastu Mam Partha Devim Prakritim Ashritaha Bhajantyananyamanasaha Nyatva Bhotadim Avyayam. Dealing with Maya, you require bhakti. That is the only one weapon. That's what introduced in the verse number 13, elaborated in the verse number 14. And those people who are endowed with Sattva Guna Maya, will make effort, they become very serious, they fix a proper goal and they are sticking with the proper goal strongly, firmly, and they don't bother about anything else. Nitya yuktaha upasate. Serious nishkama bhaktas are introduced in that. Bhakti means it's a nishkama bhakti. That is the only one solution to get rid of suffering. That which helps to get the enlightened of Ishvara. That is the way bhakti is introduced up to 14th verse. In the 15th verse, he gives complete knowledge about bhakti once again, which was given in the 7th chapter. He gives, there are three kinds of bhaktis: ekarupa bhakti, anekarupa bhakti, arupa bhakti. Ekarupa bhakti is the preliminary level. And anekarupa bhakti means it's a second and middle level. We call it intermediary level. Then the third level is higher level, known as Uttama Adhikari, is taken as highest bhakti. These three level of bhakti is gradual growth among the people. The basic bhakti will bring the worldly materialistic success, but the second level brings the spiritual success. The third level bhakti is the bhakti so which is endowed with benefit alone. These three kinds of bhaktis are based on three kinds of understanding we should remember. Because we are seeing the summary, so we should have a proper segment in our mind. Why? Because so if we lose little bit somewhere, the connection will be lost. Ekarupa bhakti is based on what? With the understanding God is the creator, the world is created. God is sitting somewhere else in Vaikuntha, Kailasha. Then we can have the bhakti. That is known as ekarupa bhakti. That ekarupa means sticking with one finite form of the Ishvara. You can take Mahavishnu as one who is the creator. You can take or you can take Lord Shiva is the only one who is creating the world. If you are a worshipper of mother, she is the creator. So like ekarupa bhakti, if you develop little bit more, you can get anekarupa bhakti based on the understanding that God alone has become the world. This is second level understanding, which is the base of second level bhakti called Vishwarupa bhakti, anekarupa bhakti or Virat bhakti. The third level bhakti after knowledge. So once you are understood the para prakriti, then you will get the bhakti. It's known as arupa bhakti. Only bhakti remains. At that time, God alone exists. World doesn't. World has got a false reality. Mithya adhisthanam. That's what said in the verse number 15. From 16 onwards, up to 19th words, Bhagavan Krishna just considers the reader of Bhagavad Gita as intermediary bhaktas, madhyama bhaktas. Therefore, he gives the solutions, the way, the detail of this bhakti called Vishwarupa bhakti is introduced, verse number up to 19th words. Then he analyzes between sakama bhakti and nishkama bhakti from verse number 20. By this two verses, verse number 20 and 21 completely talks about sakama bhakti. Sakama bhakti means what? Basic level bhakti, first level bhakti, preliminary bhakti. In the preliminary bhakti, what we ask for money, power, status, and more Lakshmi Kataksha and more world. On the earth, what and all we ask, and after that also we can ask more than that. That's what he mentions. You can ask up to Satya Loka or Brahma Loka. Clearly, you know, all these lokas will be provided when you use them in the form of wishes, desire in the bhakti. Sakama bhakti is very fruitful, you will get everything. But only the thing is, the minus point of Sakama bhakti, you should be very careful whatever the rituals are prescribed, you have to follow as it is. The quantity of the materials and quality of the materials must be provided. So this much brahmana should be there means you have to arrange that much brahmanas. If there are 32 brahmanas means you have to bring. You need to have paisa, money. At the same time, whatever the prayojana you get up to brahmaloka, but all of them are limited. So you will be provided enjoyment. Once the enjoyment is completed, you will be coming back to the same position where you began. That's what big minus point of Sakama Bhakti, which is explained from verse number 20 and 21. Then from verse number 22 to 29, he continuously comparing this Nishkama Bhakti with the Sakama Bhakti, how one can develop himself to be a Sakama Bhakta. He divides into two, Ajnani Bhakti, Jnani Bhakti like. Because both Bhakti has got a motive. Ajnani Bhakti also has got a destination, motive is to get more power, more money, more security. But this Jnani Bhakti, little bit he is informed. He fixes God alone my destination. Then it is converted into as a Nishkama Bhakti. God alone is my destination. Like this, he introduced up to verse number 29. In the beginning of this concept, as the 22nd verse itself, he gave a very important verse. I repeated many times, Ananyaschintayanto maam ye janah pariyupasate Yesham Nityabhiyuktanam Yogakshemam Vahamyaham. This is the bridge verse, the verse which is like a bridge. Sakama Bhakti to Nishkama Bhakti. You can travel through this understanding which is in the form of bridge. This verse says, my dear, if you take your life is your responsibility, I am ready to you to provide whatever that you ask. Because you think house will bring security. Hey Bhagavan, ghar de de, provide house, I will give. You think power will give security. Hey Bhagavan, provide power, I will give. And if you think the old worldly things will give security and peace, therefore you ask me, I will provide everything. But all of them are limited. Only that I am aware, you are not aware. But if ask me, okay, I will give me, means if you are surrendering completely yourself, not worrying about worldly security and pleasure, it becomes my responsibility, man, to take care of you. Therefore, ananyaha chintayantaha, it's known as ananya bhakti. Not believing on any worldly object, just fixing me as the target. Bhagavan is the shelter, Bhagavan is the security, Bhagavan is ananda swarupi. Then that becomes my responsibility to take care of your all welfare. I will give whatever the objects you need in the form of materialistic aspects, in the form of spiritualistic aspects, I will provide. Yoga kshemam aham vahami. I ask to note that line. That is the transformation from Sakama Bhakti to Nishkama Bhakti. First he said the minus point of Sakama Bhakti in the previous two verses. Now he is helping us to travel to Nishkama Bhakti. Travel means getting transformation. Then he analyzes the Sakama Bhakti and Nishkama Bhakti, the plus and minus in the verse number 23. Okay. Then he gives the secret why Nishkama Bhakti is the higher level Bhakti by verse number 24, 25 and 26. While concluding in the 26, he gave one more punch. While beginning, he said, Aham Bahami Yoga Kshema. I will provide whatever you need, man. If you are thinking me alone, your destination, that becomes my responsibility. I will take care of you. Okay? While finishing, while completing that concept, again he says, that patram pushpam phalam toyam yo me bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhaktyupahrutam ashnami prayatatmanah. This nishkama bhakti doesn't have the minus point which sakama bhakti has. Because in order to show the bhakti, you should worship. Worshipping needs materials. But nishkama bhakti doesn't need worldly materials. The quantity is not the matter. The quality is not the matter. The only thing, your shraddha does matter. If you put a small amount of pushpa, or pushpa means flowers, if you offer one flower or one leaf, there are certain leaves like a vilva, tulasi, etc., etc. And there are so many flowers. If it is not possible, just water. One spoon of water. That's all. Or something which you can. That's enough. In order to show your Shraddha, I will flourish bone. If at all you not having anything, just you offer whatever you do. That's what from verse number 27. Beautiful words. These two verses. So, 22nd, in which he says, Aham Yoga Kshemam Vahami. And verse number 26, where he says, the materials are not matter in the Nishkama Bhakti. But Sakama Bhakti, you have to follow the rules and regulations which are provided by the Vedas. In the 27th verse, he says, just surrender everything to me. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you do as in the business, or whatever you do spiritual activities, you just surrender to me. Yatkaroshi yadashnasi yajyuhoshi dadasiyat yattapasyasi kaunteya tatkurushvamadarpanam. We have to rewrite it. Every day we have to say yatkaromi yadashnami yajyuhomi dadami yat yattapasyami bhagavan tatkaromi tvadarpanam. You just convert into first person so that you could communicate with Ishwara. Beautiful sloka. Then he gives the benefit of this nishkama karma, the verse number 28. He gets rid of both bonds called punya and papa. Then what happens? The final verse, verse number 29, he says, so if you have bhakti, which is known as nishkama bhakti, you will come to know I am equal to all. I don't consider according to the worldly materials. For me, a person who is bringing gold coin, for me, the person who brings only flower, so farak nahi padta. If he is with sakama karma, I will give according to the material. If that person is endowed with nishkama karma, I will give myself. That's what he concludes in the verse number 29. Then from verse number 30 onwards, up to the end of the chapter, he glorifies the bhakti. Bhakti is the material which can do wonder. If anybody asks, what is the wonder in this world? I can say bhakti. Only bhakti. You need not to have intelligence at all. Anyway, you know, people think who has the bhakti, they are less intelligent, less confident. That's what world thinks. You have to know about science a little bit. You should know about the world a little bit. That's all. Then you are considered intelligence. But if you take Bhagavan as the shelter, you become useless for them. But Bhagavan says, no intelligence is needed. Just have the bhakti. That bhakti will elevate you. You need to have the capacity to realize him. That is not worldly intelligence. This intelligence, it comes its own. It comes because of his own belief. How, you know, worst you are doesn't matter. How disqualified you are doesn't matter. Doesn't matter at what age you are. Doesn't matter what field you belong to. Doesn't matter what the quality that you have in your life. If you convert yourself into bhakti, you jump into the bhakti, you will find the miracles. That's what he started from verse number 30. In the verse number 31, he assures, Name bhakta pranashyati. You have to keep repeating these three verses. Verse number 22, he says, Aham yoga kshemam vahami. And verse number 26, he says, I don't care about the materials. In the verse number 31, he says, Name bhaktaha, me bhaktaha na pranashyati. My devotee never perishes because I am there for him. So how big, you know, the blessings that we have. Bhakti is everything. That's what he concludes. Then in the last verse, he gives five factors of bhaktis, how they would be. Nishkama bhaktas are just explained. Nishkama bhakta means what? They are endowed with my bhakti. Without bhakti, they are not there. And they fix me as the goal, not the materialistic aspects. They don't fix the security as their goal. No, they fix me as the goal. Therefore, I run towards them to secure them. I should take care of them. Matparayanaha. Then manmanaha. They don't get deviated out of me. Okay. Then mam namaskuru. They are endowed with humility. That's what the glory of bhakti. Thus the ninth chapter completes. Let us just read the completing sentence. Ite Srimad Bhagavad Gitasu Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Samvade Raja Vidya Raja Guhya Yoga Nama Navamodhyayah. The Bhagavad Gita, which is in the form of dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna, the name of the chapter, which is called Rajavidya Raja Guhyam, which exists in the Mahabharata, which is nothing but the essence of Upanishad, which is considered as Yoga Sutra, is ending. We will begin the next chapter from next session tomorrow in the next episode. Harihi Om.